Now joining us from the White House is Deputy National Security Advisor Denis McDonough. Welcome, Mr. McDonough. We just heard Secretary Gates say that there could be any number of possible outcomes. What is the desired and immediate outcome that the White House is hoping for?
Gwen, thanks a lot for the opportunity to be with you tonight. I really appreciate it. Look, the president explained to the country last Friday afternoon that we are setting aside for ourselves a very tightly defined, finite, accomplishable mission here in the early part of this effort, where we're going to shape the environment using our unique assets and then enable our international colleagues, our allies in Europe, and our partners in the Arab world to take over the conduct of the no-fly zone. We're making good strides toward that. He also set out an effort to try to protect the civilians in Benghazi. We have done that thanks to the good work of our Marines, our sailors, our airmen, and we're making good progress towards both of those goals. What happens after then is obviously we're going to watch the UN continue to do its work. Importantly, you'll remember that the UN appointed a special envoy in the first Security Council resolution about 2 weeks ago now. So we're going to continue to work with the international community, drawing on all the resources, not just our resources, which at the moment are quite taxed, giving everything that the United States is doing in Japan, in Afghanistan, in Iraq. We think it's an appropriate division of labor here, and we're working with our colleagues to set that up.
Both House Speaker John Boehner just this afternoon and even Democrats like Senator Jim Webb have said that the U.S. has lacked a clear policy and certainly hasn't consulted widely enough with Congress. What do you say to them?
Well, we got a letter from the Speaker today. We look forward to continuing the conversation with him. The President had a very good meeting with him on Friday. I happened to have a good discussion with him on Saturday. We've been talking with Congress about this now for a couple weeks. But the bottom line is we had an opportunity to move after we had brought the international community along with us last Thursday night in that UN Security Council resolution. We had an opportunity to move with alacrity and speed and agility, as our armed forces always do, and protected Benghazi. And we've turned the Gaddafi forces around. We feel pretty good about that. But now it's up to working with our international colleagues to establish the kind of command and control that Jim referred to a minute ago. Work with Prime Minister Cameron and his conference next week in London, where the international community, Europeans, Arabs, international organizations, put a political plan together to make sure that we have the future that the Libyans want. So this is going to be a comprehensive effort. But importantly, Gwen, it's not resting solely on our shoulders. It's something that we're going to share with the international community. And we think we're making good progress on
and
that.
And the international community had another meeting today in which there was no progress made on this idea of handing this over to NATO. Secretary Clinton talked about handing it over to NATO. You talked about having a finite plan. Others have talked about it being days, not weeks, until this happens. Is it going to happen? I believe there you are. You're back with us. Go ahead.
I just don't think that's accurate, Gwen, to say that we haven't made progress at NATO. As I think you saw in the newspapers today, starting this morning, we were enforcing the arms embargo as a result of NATO action. We're finalizing the command and control infrastructure for the no-fly zone. But we know what's important. Over the last 2 days, the enforcement of the no-fly zone was done principally, if not entirely, by non-U.S. airplanes. Now, the United States still flew important missions as it relates to gathering intelligence, as it relates to fueling those airplanes, and as it relates to jamming certain communications. But the bottom line is that this is now the international community that's stepping up. So I just don't agree with the premise of the question.
Secretary Clinton said that it would be easiest if Colonel Gaddafi left. And we heard Admiral Mullen, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, say earlier this week that he didn't know if that's going to happen, that they had to envision a possibility that he would still be in office even after this is over. How do you determine success, and how do you know if he is still there that the entire cycle doesn't begin again?
Well, you know, we didn't set out to do regime change here. We set out, as I said, to do a very targeted mission, which is to enable, to shape the environment using our unique assets to enable our international partners to take over the no-fly zone. We're on the verge of doing that. We also said, as the president outlined to the country on Friday afternoon, that we're going to make sure that we turn back Gaddafi's forces from Benghazi. We've done that. I'm very proud of the work of our forces, Marines, sailors, airmen, soldiers. They've done that a great sacrifice, but with great agility and great alacrity. And we've turned back what everybody assumed was going to be a siege of Benghazi. So we set out these very concrete efforts. We're going to fulfill those. Then we're going to bring the rest of the international community along so, again, we can share some of this burden because, again, we're asking our troops to do an awful lot. And, frankly, we're asking the American people to do an awful lot right now. Well, and we think that we ought to right-size this thing so that we do it just right.
Help me get this right. You are defining success as holding Gaddafi's forces back from these key cities, Benghazi, Zawiya, other cities, Misrata, and then handing this over, at least the lead position over, to international partners. The U.S. would still be involved, though.
Oh, in fact, we ensured that the United Nations Security Council resolution that was passed last Thursday night had additional tools to allow us to be involved, but not solely our military. We're asking our military to do an awful lot right now. So what we've made sure is that there's non-military tools, additional sanctions, additional limitations on arms that get to him, additional ability to freeze his assets so we can set aside that money. That's not the money for him and his family, Gwen. That's the Libyan people's money. So that's set aside for them, frozen assets, until there's a change in Libya so that they can have the kind of future and make the kind of investments that Libyans want in education and opportunity. So we'll be involved. Of course we will.
The success of this mission, then, is not necessarily whether we leave or whether we stay. It's what? I guess I'm trying to figure out what is the exit strategy.
Well, we're not talking about an exit strategy. What we, as I said, the president defined it very clearly the other night in terms of our initial efforts in this undertaking. We carved out a space where we'll be able to enable our partners to take over the no-fly zone. We've turned the troops back from Benghazi, protected those civilians, and we continue to degrade his forces so they can't undertake the kind of mass atrocity that we all feared just a week ago, and as you reported on your show. So that's an initial success, but the longer-term success is going to take additional efforts, and it's not going to be a solely military effort by any means.
Will we hear from the president again on this week?
Oh, the president's been talking about it an awful lot, and you'll continue to hear from him because he does think it's important not only to explain to the American people, but to express his appreciation for our armed forces, all the work that they're doing, and frankly, all the work that our humanitarian assistance workers are doing to ensure that there's food and water for those Libyans. And so you'll hear the president talk more and more about it.
Deputy National Security Advisor Denis McDonough, thank you very much.
Thanks, Gwen.